A cool tagline for a show about observability would be qui custodit custodes, but Zack Snyder ruined it for everyone. It's the uptime. So a few weeks ago, we had Peter Pizarris from the CodeStream team on the NerdBlock. And I'm just realizing now how weird it sounds to say CodeStream team out loud, but Peter's a good guy, and it was a really good show with him on. You could say it was a CodeStream livestream dream team. So, CodeStream is a way for developers to collaborate on code. And I know what you're going to say, GitHub, but stay with me. What was document collaboration before Google Docs? You could definitely share documents, even see somewhere a history of changes, but you still collaborated by shipping multiple versions of the document around. This interface meant that even with a change history on my old docs, I still end up writing an email like, hey, just made a few updates, tweaked the title, and wrote a whole new intro. And here's the thing, that's what code collaboration with Git feels like. There's no way to collaborate within your IDE. You have to do a whole commit just for everyone to see that you have questions about some line of code. CodeStream brings all that commenting, sharing, tracking into the IDE, letting you see as you scroll down, hey, Dave asked a question about this method 2 weeks ago. It's a pretty amazing tool, and I think that improved code collaboration is going to be a goal for software teams next year. Okay, what's the New Relic angle, beyond that we acquired CodeStream? Well, what if you could go directly from an error in the New Relic errors inbox to the line of code that threw the error right inside your IDE? If you ask me, that sounds pretty neat. New Relic CodeStream integration is available for a free preview in all regions outside of EMEA. You'll never guess where I put the link to the documentation. That's right, the show notes. Way back in the day, back when there wasn't a single decent cup of boba tea to be had in Portland, Oregon, I did tech support for New Relic. It's how I got my start in the tech industry. One of the questions that used to come up from time to time, and that I always loved talking about, was you'd have someone who had zoomed way in on the extremely recent past. They were looking at a chart of throughput for just the last 5 minutes, and the chart showed sudden drop-off. If it was 10 a.m., somehow at 9:59, most users had abandoned the site. The maddening thing was that if you waited and refreshed, that drop-off would disappear, but now you'd see a new one. Refreshing at 10:05 a.m. showed you that almost everyone had stopped sending requests at 10:04. The explanation was that the chart was showing them data for a time period that wasn't over yet. Of course, half of your throughput wasn't showing up because not every request had yet been reported. This could happen even in an idealized world. In a world where a horse race is just spheres traveling through a vacuum, you still can have problems with latency and time bucketing. But in the real world, you see it all the time. Latency means the New Relic collector might not get full data for quite a while. You might still be getting traces from requests sent and responded to at 10:01 a.m. as late as 10:10 a.m. or 10:20. At the time I was answering emails for New Relic, all I could really say was, this is a statistical illusion, and you can safely ignore it. And I couldn't really fix it for the user. By the way, in the years since, the default behavior has improved quite a bit, so much so that I couldn't replicate the problem in the modern New Relic dashboard. But the latency thing really does raise some questions. How long should we be waiting to get additional reports since waiting hours until we have perfect data will mean a lot of latency in things like alerts? Brian Galeno gave a great talk about how this works and how we now support a variety of aggregation methods that let you decide how long we wait before saying, okay, done. This is how many requests you got during this particular minute. Hey, thank you again for registering for Data Nerd Days. If you message me at serverless_mom on Twitter, I'll say thank you personally. The variety of aggregation methods now available means you can still get alerts even if the metrics you're alerting on are very infrequent, like more than 30 minutes apart. Another thing I remember from doing support is when people would ask, hey, I want an alert if this metric ever goes above zero. This makes sense if your transactions do things like move around tens of thousands of dollars. Even a couple of errors might be worth an alert. Those kinds of aggregation and alerting decisions are now in your hands with these settings. Check out the docs in the show notes, and Brian's full talk is available in a link below. It's a good one and well worth your time. So, OpenTelemetry is the future. I don't know if specific OpenTelemetry instrumentation libraries or data collection tools will get used in 10 years, but I will say that the OpenTelemetry project has successfully defined what needs to be transmitted in order to have solid observability into your running software. Briefly, that's the three pillars of metrics, logs, and distributed tracing. When you look at the open source New Relic language agents, you'll see the intricacies involved in trying to measure what's really happening inside a web application. Even simple questions like when does a request start and end can be complex to answer. And getting you the beautiful traces that show individual methods being called is, let's just say that I was never a good enough programmer to work on such tools. Open source telemetry means that everyone working on a software project can engineer it from the start to emit metrics in a way that anyone can read and understand, and that's powerful. I don't need to remind you that right now more than half of all web developers use no observability tool at all. OpenTelemetry really might be the way that that changes. So where does New Relic come in? We are now accepting OpenTelemetry data sent by the OTLP protocol, giving you a reliable way to store all that OTEL data. And guess what? This is New Relic, so you don't just have a place to store that data. You can query it, display it, and generate alerts and reports based on that data. What I love about this is how it combines with the free tier for life. If you go sign up for a free account today and monitor your personal projects, you'll be able to keep doing that forever without having to upgrade to a paid plan. Probably, you know, your mileage may vary. If you click the link down below this video to sign up for a free account, it'll help me make episodes of the show. And if you screenshot your sign up and send it to me at serverless_mom on Twitter, I will send you some swag.